Welcome back to the Keypoints live on TV3 and 3FM. So almost some 30 years ago, multi-party democracy started and it birthed the new patriotic party. Over the week, the NPP commemorated in a muted manner due to the COVID pandemic, 29 years of their party. Let's hear John Bwedu, who is the general secretary of the party.
This country that has implemented more social intervention program than the new patriotic party. We have also initiated setting up of the party institute that will take party people through the study of communication, policy analysis, our ideology, understanding our ideology, research and other related political issues.
And that's John Bwedu. He is the general secretary of the NPP. So he says that in as much as the party is a center-right party, they have implemented the most significant social economic interventions in the country and listed some of them. The president, Nana Akufo-Addo, was a national organizer of the party in the early days and has been with the party really from the very beginning. Let's hear what he had to say on that commemoration day.
And I'm very, very confident of it, that on the 7th of December 2024, the new NPP presidential candidate is going to win the election of 2024. So our objective, our responsibility is to do whatever it is necessary to make sure that that victory is forthcoming. We have to continue our way forward in Ghana. We cannot accept the backsliding that takes place every now and then. It hasn't benefited our nation, and it will not benefit our nation. The foundations that we're laying today for the prosperity of our nation are going to be shaken if, again, through our own fault, we allow the path to progress to be diverted.
And you're welcome back. So you heard the president there talking about what he sees in terms of the future, looking immediately at 2024 and really for the future. The party, the NPP's slogan is development in freedom. And I guess it's not just a slogan for them, it's meant to be for all of us. So have they delivered that for us? Let me start with Dr. Ali Dusedu, because he's a political scientist and you've certainly been following the politics of our country for a while, have studied it. Would you say that the NPP over 29 years have delivered on what they've promised?
Yeah, to some extent, I think the NPP as a party have contributed to deepening our multi-party democracy in this country. And I think you can trace the traditional route of the NPP to, I think, 1947, yes, when the UGCC was formed, 4 August. So I think that seed of democratic development in freedom was sowed on that particular day. And the permutations up to the fourth republic. If I want to assess the MPP, I'll look at it from three fronts. One, I'll look at it from the theoretical perspective. That basically has to do with the ideology and whether they have stick to their ideology over time. And then two, so it's both theory and practical. And the practical, I'll focus on the MPP as a political institution and whether it has lived up to that particular mandate. And then MPP as a government, what it has done. So as an institution, as a political institution, the MPP has done quite a lot. It has been able to train and build the capacity of its core membership from the student level up to national political level. They have produced leaders. They have built capacity of various institutions. They have set up a permanent bureaucracy as a political party to be able to help but the capacity of individuals who identify themselves as members of the party and to translate that capacity that they have earned to the collective development of the country. Yes, political parties generally face a lot of challenges in the country and the NPP is not immune from that. But on that particular front, they have done relatively well. Looking at the history that they have traveled up to the Fourth Republic, they have really done so well. In terms of governance, there is a kind of mixed thing. They've done a lot. in deepening our democracy, passing laws, implementing policies and programs that seeks to improve the lives and the livelihood of the people. They have also made a lot of governance mistakes. You know, there have been a decline in the ranking of press freedom, the alleged harassment of journalists, and then largely the politicization of state institutions and all those things. When you are assessing them, looking at the very good policies they've implemented, the social intervention programs, deepening our democracy, passing legislation that makes Ghana democracy grow, they are all part of assessment of the governor, not the ideology. And I like what the president said about the fact that on 2025, power will be handed over to an NPP government. I think there's still time to debate this. No, one, because no, if you look at the political ideology of
I think the critical thing he put there is it doesn't matter who will be the flag bearer.
It matters.
Whoever we'll talk about, but I guess that was an interesting.
So that is going to feed into my ideology.
Felix is salivating.
So in terms of ideology, the NPP is not only a center right, but it is a conservative party. And see, conservatism has some peculiar traditions, especially in terms of what? Respect for customs, traditions, and continuity. The MPP over the years, that's what we call the principle of prescription. They have respected the core founding members of their party, and they have held them in high esteem. The party realized that we can't be where we are if we didn't stood on the shoulders of giants. So they have always mentioned their founding members, they have cherished them, they have named state institutions. They've done a lot of things to reward them. So the custom and the traditions go. But if you look at, there's a competing interest when you look at customs, traditions, and what? Continuity. There are two basic issues, permanence and progression. The permanence has to do with the fact that they are highly suspicious of people who are not core part of their membership. So that's why people think that climbing in progressing in the MPP is quite a daunting task compared to the NDC, because there is a queue. You have to obey the queue, respect the tradition, follow people who have twirled earlier. So that kind of a thing brings that element of permanence, because you cannot disregard the tradition of the party. And there are a lot of people who are still hardcore conservative people who believe in permanence and retaining the traditions and customs of the party. But there are also people who are more progressive. You see, laws or ideology is not cast in stone. You look at the circumstances, the opportunity, and then you gradually liberalize or change or progress in terms of those things. So people are thinking that over the years, you see, for example, the social democratic, a liberal democratic party shouldn't pride itself with implementing social intervention policies, theoretically. But this is what the journalist is looking for, because over the years you've seen that things have changed, and you have to respond to what? The needs of the people based on the circumstance, no matter what the ideology says. But lastly, people think that given how far we have come, we need to disregard that custom and tradition bed and look at progression. Can we get people who are more progressive, and then we liberalize gradually to be able to attain what is going to, and that is going to be the major contest in who leads the party in 2024. Is it going to be Alan, who is more conservative traditional, and people who believe in conservatism and tradition, that President Kufuor contested Adubo Ahene before he led Nana Dodon Akufo-Addo contested Kufuor, Alan contested Nana, so he should lead? Or where does Dr. Bawumia Mahamadou comes in? So the issue of progression, and the issue of permanence, is going to be a major ideological fight moving into 2024. And in most cases, this has collapsed political parties, and in some cases, they have rebranded political parties and make them stronger. So it's still something very important that we need to look at moving into 2024.
And I deliberately wanted you to give us this exposition for the benefit of many young ones who may be watching and may not have this kind of backstory in terms of the MPP and the like. At the time I became a journalist, that was during the era of Dambotre, who was general secretary, and the chairman was Haruna Eseku and the like, but kind of followed them up until now. So Mr. Boabeng Asamoah, I mean, kudos, the NPP at 29. Other parties have fallen by the wayside. Would you ascribe to the issues of, you know, looking at permanence, ensuring continuity, tradition as part of the success?
I thank you very much for giving the NPP the opportunity to be in the public space on your platform this morning. And I'm glad your platform, Dr. Alidu, has endorsed the NPP. Academically.
Is that an endorsement?
I didn't say politically.
Okay.
Academically. and described literally in his opinion who we are ideologically and the way we position ourselves. In several respects, he may not be far from wrong, but we are who we are, and then we know our history, and we know the way forward, as it were. So there are certain things that ideologically may not seem to sit with what we say we are, but pragmatically, leading Ghana, we seek to do, because that's the right thing to do for Ghanaians, and that's what will take our society forward. So though we are conservative, we're also pragmatic. The right of center, we are pragmatic. This is what Kufuor described as capitalism with the human face. That is how come in the society we are, people needing to build social capital so rapidly, the NPP has taken it upon itself in its role as a genuine society builder, as a genuine nation builder, to take on the social interventions required to bring our social capital up to speed, education, health, so that the people can realize their private talents for the benefit of the whole nation. So having said that, let me begin from the end, being the president's statement and how Doc described it. My understanding of what the president said is that our record is so solid that our contention for continued leadership is not necessarily about the individual who steps into his shoes as president, but the collective record of the party, the ability of the party to drive things forward. Because the party owns the policies that the government is implementing. The party has taken on the policies Kufuor developed. The party is taking on the policies Anadu has developed and is implementing. And these policies are deeply rooted in our psyche, our liberal traditions, and the way we see that our society must be built. And therefore, if you have the party imbibing these policies and traveling forward with these policies, if you look at our manifestos from 92 all the way through, they just keep building up on these themes, and you find them linked backwards to the Popular Front Party, Progress Party, and all the way back to UGCC. That focus on building up human rights, that focus on entrenching the rule of law. And what is the benefit of rule of law? It gives fair opportunity to everybody. It elevates law above human beings, and it therefore produces certainty and predictability in society. That's why we are so fixed on rule of law. You move beyond individual human beings, the whims and enterprises of individuals, and you get a situation where anybody, without recourse to your status, your gender, anything, your ethnic extraction, have equal opportunity to the benefits the state can confer. That's why rule of law is so important to us. And then, of course, the freedoms of speech, association, and all that, which we have championed since the UGCC days, complements rule of law. Because we believe that when the individual is free, the individual can explode their talents in the framework of the social capital that the government provides. And in doing so, the individual is fulfilled. It can lift other people. That's the private sector part of what we do. That once the individual is empowered, equipped, that individual can bring innovation, productivity to another level and drag along another person. So you take away the burden of everything being on the government, especially employment. So we have that three-pronged thing. You're doing the rule of law, you are ensuring human rights, and then you are engaging the private sector to take advantage of this environment and bring itself and all others up along with all of us. So what you do is that you protect their rights and their... So you have our motto, development in freedom. We will develop in freedom. It is still a heavily contested situation, and Doc will agree with me that there are still those political scientists who don't believe that democracy leads to development. There are two different things. The fact that you are entitled to vote does not mean you'll be well off. It's still a debate. But we in the MPP believe strongly that the more free you are within the limits, within the rules, the more likely that you contribute to development in a better structured manner. And this nexus was developed by Dr. J.B. Dankwa, well before, years before, when he made that famous statement that the MPP now has taken on as lodestone.
So I'll come back to you on that. And Felix, I know you've been taking copious notes.
Let me just wrap up quickly.
Okay, just
So that day, the event we had that
commemoration,
day
yes.
was on two legs. Mm. Apart from the theme, stability, prosperity and continuity. And stability in the sense that we have contributed to a stable democratic process over the 29 years based on our belief in rule of law and all those things. So we have a stable society. And that is, political stability is a brand that Ghana is benefiting from worldwide. Political stability. Then, prosperity. We are growing the economy. Every time we are in charge, we believe we add qualitative growth to this economy, which is of permanent nature. And so that is why we are asking Ghana to continue as in power. Continuity. We are asking Ghana to. So on that day, we're looking at two pillars. One, thanking all of Ghana, including the NDC. Thanking all of Ghana for this collective enterprise that has brought us this far. And expecting that we will continue in that vein. And the 2020 election, because of COVID, was one of the ones where this system was most threatened. There were voices about not having an election at all, if you remember. The president was very resolute and resilient, and we had one of the best elections ever. So that thank you to the people of Ghana. The second leg of the thank you is that we are asking Ghanaians to look at our record in government and continue as in power. And that's where the president comes in and says that with that record, don't over-focus on the leadership struggle. It will come. The president is going out of office. He will not extend his term by constitutional fiat. He's going out of office. So somebody must lead us. Question is, who does? There are about five or six claimants, but we all know that there are two front runners. Doc has been able to ideologize them already.
Yeah.
I will not go that far. But I will say that the MPP as a political entity is determined to have a fair race, that everybody involved will be given the opportunity to demonstrate to the MPP first in primaries what they can do, what they add to the ticket. Because the ticket is the party's achievements, the two previous presidents, and the policies that Ghanaians feel enamored of, the policies that are benefiting Ghanaians as we speak. That is the bedrock. And then that leader is seeking to add on. So the value addition is what we are going to look at. Who adds value to that bedrock, which is the party? And it will be contested in a primary. We have to, we are very zealous and enthusiastic. We love competition. So already there's a bit of competitiveness. And the party has taken steps to rein in excess competition at this stage so that nobody picks too early. The party's view is that anything you do now is just to demonstrate that you have an interest in running. You are not going to be given different policy measures because you are part of a government that was elected 7 months ago on a clear ticket. And that ticket is being implemented. So you are not coming to appeal to the public to lead the party in the next 3 years on the basis of different policies. So if it is just about introducing yourself to the public, we in the party believe that already, based on Dr. Alidu's analysis, the progressives, the conservatives, whatever, and the history of the party, we know who are in contention. So there's a code of conduct seeking to restrict or seeking to moderate the ground now until the time when the general secretary, the political party, says, now we are free to go out there. Then we'll see policies and programs, the value addition that these candidates bring to us. And I'm telling you, it is that process that the president is saying that whoever triumphs will be adding value to the ticket and we should then win. So it is not the other way around. It is not the personality who is going to win us the election. It is the value addition the personality brings to the solid party platform that we have already, the platform of policies that are already benefiting Ghanaians.
All right. Mr. Kwachi Fosu, the NPP, 29 years of it, they've become formidable in, you know, matching the NDC as well, because the NDC came, had the benefit of the revolutionary era and almost the same people coming in, presenting strongly in 92, even though the NPP boycotted those elections afterwards. I mean, they did the parliamentary, but then decided to boycott the presidential and so weren't even in parliament entirely. Then in 96, they came in, led by J.H. Mensah at that time, of course. And I guess... as president, I mean in parliament.
Yes.
And so they've also grown that capacity. I'm sure there are many people who may have not thought that they would, you know, come this far and really be a formidable competition to the NDC.
Well, I mean, to the extent that they are one of two dominant parties in Ghana, you could say that they've made a contribution. Except that the records would show that they were disruptive at the very beginning for very frivolous reasons. They decided to abstain from the drawing up of the constitution, which has become the bedrock upon which this whole democratic experiment has been built thus far. Again, when elections were held and they were thrashed convincingly at the polls, they decided that they were not going to go to parliament. So for 4 years, they deprived their membership and the section of Ghanaians who believed in the ideologies a voice in parliament. Later on, they decided to mainstream and do the things that regular political parties are supposed to do. So they've evolved from a very disruptive force to a force that has shown that at least they are willing to take part in the democratic exercise. Again, congratulations will be in order to the extent that they are marking a milestone. But you see, the NPP has a penchant for saying one thing and doing the other. You know, they are a bundle of contradictions. They engage a lot in sloganeering that does not translate into substantive actions on the ground. So for instance, there is a party that claims at the very beginning that they were formed on the basis of intellectualism and deep thought and, if you like, contributions that had finesse, contributions that were substantive. And yet, if you compare the party today to what their founding fathers say they stood for, they are barely recognizable. They have rapidly descended into a party that now believes in thuggery, state-sponsored violence. I mean, you have a situation where a whole party can be in power, and yet clad party militia with arms and ammunition of the state and send them to assault members of the opposition who are doing nothing more than participating in an election. We have had instances where these thugs have actually been integrated into regular security forces and they are engaged in actions that are extrajudicial, that simply are not lawful, and nothing is done about it. A party that purports to subscribe to intellectualism does not behave this way. Again, there's a party that says that they believe in freedoms. And yet today, at no point under the Fourth Republic, have we had the freedoms of people emasculated the way that it has happened today. You are in the media. As I speak to you, two prominent opposition stations, Radio Gold and Munsi FM, remain closed for reasons that are frivolous and completely untenable. They have been closed. And the reason why they've been closed is that they are known to be very critical of the New Patriotic Party and their leader. No party can subscribe to freedom and behave in the manner that they have behaved. Again, there's a party that says that they are willing to run the country well, run the country on the basis of good governance, on the basis of rule of law. We just finished discussing the Sputnik matter, in which our laws were vandalized, were violated with impunity, and no actions have been taken. There's a party that is superintending corruption on a grand scale. We are talking governmental corruption in a manner that we have never seen before. And I could cite examples for you. We are talking about a party that has practiced nepotism in its very worst forms. The administration that President Akufo-Addo has presided is brimming with his relatives. These are things that you do not do when you subscribe to the ideology that the NPP says it subscribes to. The other issue is that they suffer an identity crisis. Whereas they claim to be a center-right party that hankers after conservatism, they have drifted into shallow populism, all in a manner intended to win elections. So you find that they do things that are completely diametrically opposite what they say they stand for.
But if you say, and I'm sorry to interrupt you, because when you say shallow populism, I'll explain to you. Are you saying that free SH is shallow populism?
They go about saying
Are you saying that NHIS is populism? Are you saying that these policies to provide and improve the lives of people like LEAP is shallow populism.
Listen to the narrative. They say that they are engaged in social interventions.
The truth is, in Ghana, it's a developing country.
If you let me make my point, you see, what they have done is that for partisan reasons, they have deliberately chosen a very narrow interpretation of what a social intervention is. And that all that they think constitutes a social intervention is to say that something is free. And they completely disregard any other investment that is made in the social sector. When you speak about a social intervention, you are simply saying that government is investing in the social sector. So education, health, social services, provision of basic needs of people, all of that constitutes social interventions. But to the extent that they ascribe social interventions to things that are free, you can accuse them of adopting a very narrow interpretation. The truth is that the NPP will not come close to the NDC when we do a sector-by-sector analysis of which party has contributed to Ghana's development. I'm surprised that President Akufo-Addo can actually mount the platform and say that whichever candidate they present, he will be elected. Of course, given that he's the leader of the NPP, you cannot expect him to say anything else. But if the track record of his government were ever to be set against the benchmarks that are to be used to assess whether a party continues in government, looking at the earliest opportunity. As I speak to you, they have run down the economy. Our debt is so huge and humongous that we are not in a position to pay. Our debts are unsustainable, as I speak to you. Only 2 weeks ago, the minority laid bare the facts. We used data to establish that they have driven us to a level where we cannot pay our debts. And that very, very soon, if a decision is not taken on the way forward, we are going to be default on our debts. As I speak to you, they owe so much to contractors, to suppliers. Look, they cannot even finance the printing of textbooks for basic schools that have been in operation for the last two terms.
Okay, so just on the owing of contracts, need to point to you that the roads minister has announced payments of 800 million. They've announced payments of 260 fertilizer company.
They owe over 2 billion Ghana cities contractors. They owe over 780 million Ghana cities. So these are drops in the ocean. But the reason why they are here is that they have mismanaged the economy. He claims that whenever they are in power, they make qualitative improvements on the Ghanaian economy. Check the records. The highest ever growth that this economy has recorded was under the NDC, 14.4% in 2011.
I thought that was under
President Mills. No.
In 2011. Okay, I'll have to check.
If you make my point, listen. Yeah. I'm saying that the highest ever growth rate recorded in Ghana's history, economically, is 14.4% under President Mills. Now, you can divide that to see the contribution of oil. Oil contributed under 7%. The real sector, which comprises agri, manufacturing, and all the other sectors that do not depend on oil, grew by about 8%. And the same oil.
I'll give you time. Once Felix makes a point, I'll go for a break and then I'll come back.
Check their highest ever growth rate. This was 9.2% under President Akufo. President Akufo-Addo inherited 2 more oil wells when the NDC left power, and yet the highest he could master was 7% in 2017. So when you look at the facts, you look at the figures, go to education. Who has made the biggest contributions? What was the biggest problem confronting Ghanaians in terms of education? Access. Children had to go and sit under trees. We removed over 2,000 of those schools under trees. Go to health. President Akufo-Addo has been president for 5 years, going into his 6th year. He does not boast a single district hospital. President Mahama has about 14 district hospitals to his name. He has over 22 polyclinics. President Akufo-Addo does not have any. Look at the retooling that we did. We spent close to $300 million retooling 125 hospitals across Ghana, all of them in the public sector. President Akufo-Addo does not have such a record. When we came to power in 2009, under half of Ghanaians had access to water. By the time we left power, we had added 7 million more people to those who had access to water. They have been in power for the last 6 years. Tell me what substantive contributions they've made. I'm sure you are familiar with the case of Adenta. He was MP for Adenta some time ago. And he is very familiar with what I'm saying. For about 15 years, there were people who had not seen water run through their taps. President Mahama, under the NDC government, removed it. What is President Akufo-Addo's record there?
Okay, to refer to is, you are talking about the water issue, but I know that President Akufo initiated projects that even then, a lot of the references you make is to the current Akufo-Addo administration. I'm not exactly sure if that's fair, because we're talking about NPP 29
but of
years,
course, but yes,
and former but, President Kufuor but did see, some significant things.
We
the
also,
national health insurance is a major legacy.
True.
We know before President Kufuor, even Jubilee House of Flagstaff.
I will not necessarily
yes, no, but you see the point that
was good.
But at least that is something that was
before
done.
President
there
Kufuor,
were a number of roads also.
Oh, sure,
I know.
Sure,
make it look as if
sure,
they haven't done
Jifa,
anything.
Jifa,
I'm not exactly
Jifa,
sure if that's also
before,
fair over
oh, but
the
I've not said so.
Jifa, been I've, in government.
I've not said so. Even President Liman, his government, which was the shortest lived in our history, did something. Even the payment of salaries alone is a contribution. Because government needs to mobilize the resources to pay public sector workers so they can eke out a living at the end of the month. So it is a contribution. But I'm talking about its overall impact in the development of Ghana. Before President Kufuor came was President Rawlings, who had done so much. Indeed, President Rawlings has a distinction of adding 200 more senior high schools to the existing stock. It was President Rawlings who gave 3 modern regional hospitals to the central Bunahafu and Volta regions. So I have not even counted those. I have restricted myself to just what we did in the last 8 years that Ghanaians gave us the opportunity to run this country. So if you added President Rawlings' tenor to that of Mills and Mahama, we would dwarf the MPP in every single sector. But they have this penchant for loudness, you know, going out there and making lofty claims that they did not subscribe to. Why? This is a party that in opposition harangued the party that was in power, claimed that they will fight corruption, and that they will protect the public purse, only for them to come to power and open up the public purse to systematic rape and abuse. All manner of things have been done against the public purse. Against the public purse.
So I need you to wrap up on that.
Yes, I'm going to wrap up. So the point
Mr.
is that
Babing has somewhere you so, have so all my, the time
my, so
to
my other point yes. is that so this misplaced overconfidence on the part of President Akufo-Addo that they are going to win, even if they present the goods.
Oh, he didn't say that.
Oh,
I get you,
there's something called hyperbole.
I get that, but
yeah,
it's not everyone who may get it. But
it's a hyperbolic
yes,
statement. It's a figure of speech.
It's
no. This one is a figure of speech.
Yes,
so essentially, he's saying that no matter who they present,
it's not about. It's just not about the individual per se. It's about
yes.
their record.
So that stands to reason that. Depending on the work he has done, it doesn't matter who they present, they are going to win. I'm saying that it is misplaced because if indeed he is assessed on the basis of performance alone, he should not even have won the 2020 elections.
All right.
If performance alone was the reason why people voted for government. In any event, we know that there's an established trend of 8 years. The reason why the MPP crossed the Rubicon was the 8-year rule.
Okay. So,
and having been there, look, President Kufuor, I was a critic of President Kufuor, but I can tell you that President Kufuor was far better than President Akufo-Addo, but even then they lost
okay,
in 2008. So I'm not sure where the confidence is coming from.
Okay, so we'll come back
to
that because I know that the 8-year Rubicon will come up. It's still the key points here on TV3 and 3FM. My name is Jifa Bampo, and we take a quick break and we'll be right back. We'll hear from Mr. Boabing Asamoa, the communications director of the NPP, and then of course, Dr. Ali Duseidu, senior lecturer with the University of Ghana's Political Science Department.